Good morning, respected Chairman Sir, Vice Chancellor Sir, Dr. Sudhir Sachdeva Sir, Dr. G.N. Saxena Sir, my respected teachers, seniors and my dear colleagues, myself Dr. Bhavya Thakur, third year resident from the Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology, Unit 4, will be presenting a case of a young female with severe anemia and bad obstetric history. So our patient, 26-year-old female, resident of Tong, belonging to the lower socioeconomic status, presented to our gynecology OPD with chief complaints of continuous vaginal bleeding since 1 month. She had tiredness and weakness since 1 week and her dyspnea was present since 3 days. Her vaginal bleeding was continuous since 1 month, which was heavy and was associated with passage of clots. She had weakness and tiredness since 1 week, which increased in severity over time. And there was dyspnea on exertion since 3 days. Coming to her menstrual history, she attained menarche at 14 years of age. There was no history of puberty menorrhagia. Her last menstrual period was 1 month back and she had been bleeding continuously since then. Her bleeding was heavy and was associated with passage of clots. She was changing 3 to 5 pads per day. Her last to last menstrual period was 1 month prior to this episode. Her past menstrual history was regular, lasting for 7 to 8 days at an interval of 28 to 30 days and her flow was heavy since last September. She is para 3, abortion 4 with no life issues. From 2015 to 2018, she has had 4 abortions, all of which were first trimester and followed by dilatation and evacuation. Following which, she has had 3 preterm vaginal deliveries. It's interesting to note that all of her preterm vaginal deliveries were associated with antepartum hemorrhage. Her last delivery was 3 months prior to our visit in the OPD. She gave us history of repeated hospitalization and multiple blood transfusion for similar complaint along with some intervention in 2018. There is no history of puberty menorrhagia or bleeding from any mucosal site. Her medical and surgical history was not relevant. Her family and personal history was also not relevant. So, summarizing our case based on history, our patient, 26-year-old female with continuous vaginal bleeding since 1 month with bad obstetric history. So, what all differential diagnosis can we all think about our patient? So, her differential diagnosis based on our history would be divided into 3 causes: obstetric causes, gynecological causes, and other causes. The obstetric causes will include abortion, ectopic pregnancy, hereditiform mole, gestational trophoblastic neoplasia. Gynecological causes based on the palm coin classification. Expanding the palm coin classification would be polyp, adenomyosis, leiomyoma, malignancy, coagulation disorder, ovulatory dysfunction disorders, endometrial disorders, iatrogenic or not otherwise classified, including arteriovenous malformation and isthmocele. Other causes will include local trauma and thyroid disorder. Then we did the physical examination of a patient. Our patient was conscious, cooperative, oriented to time, place and person. Her general condition was fair, pallor was present, there was no icterus, clubbing, lymphadenopathy, any bruises or ecchymosis. Her pulse rate was 110 beats per minute, BP was 100 by 60 millimeters of mercury, her SpO2 was 93% on room air. Respiratory rate was 24 per minute and her breast and thyroid examination was normal. Her systemic examination was normal except for flow murmur was heard. Then we did the gynecological examination of her patient. Her urine pregnancy test was negative. On per abdominal examination, it was soft, non-tender and there was no palpable mass. Local examination was normal. On per speculum examination, her vagina was pale, bleeding was present through os and there was presence of clots in vagina. Her cervix was healthy, there was no presence of any cervical erosion, growth or polyp. On bimanual examination, her external os was closed, cervix was pointing downwards, uterus was anteverted and anteflexed, normal in size, firm mobile and her bilateral fornices were free. So summarizing the causes of anemia based on our patient. Since our patient is belonging to lower middle socioeconomic status, there is chances of nutritional anemia. She has had history of heavy menstrual bleeding. From her obstetric history, we can make out that she has had multiple pregnancies with short interconception period. And there's also history of antepartum hemorrhage in all her previous pregnancies. Most importantly, our patient has been having continuous vaginal bleeding, per-vaginal bleeding since 1 month. So, differential diagnosis based on the examination. The obstetric causes would be ruled out as the urine pregnancy test was negative. We are ruling out the ovulatory dysfunction causes since she has had no history of irregular menstrual period in past. Endometrial causes have been ruled out as there is no history of any fever or any vaginal discharge. Iatrogenic causes have been ruled out as there is no history of any previous medication taken by the patient or any intrauterine copper device. Local trauma causes have been ruled out on examination as there is no presence of any trauma. So then we did the investigations for our patient. Her hemoglobin when she came to us in our OPD was 6.5 gram per deciliter. Rest all her investigations were within normal limits. Then we sent our patient for radiological investigation. Now I would like to call Dr. Arzu Yadav from Department of Radiodiagnosis to help us with the radiological investigation.
A 26-year-old female with complaint of menorrhagia has underwent transabdominal sonography back in 2016 at some other hospital. And the ultrasonographic findings are, this is the normal grayscale appearance of uterus and the color Doppler appearance of the uterus. But what we found in our case on grayscale, the uterus is slightly bulky and we can appreciate multiple cystic and echoic cystic tortuous or tubular structures scattered in the fundal region and in the myoid. When we put color Doppler, the cystic region generate color signals and mosaic pattern which represent high turbulent heat. This is a normal spectral study of the arterial waveform of the arcuate artery. So this is a spectral study of our case. What we found is high peak systolic velocity and low resistance. Then in 2021, patient again came to us with a history of heavy menstrual flow and we did transwedge vaginal sonography to characterize the lesion. This is the normal appearance of uterus in transvaginal sonography. But what we find in our case on grayscale image was multiple anechoic cystic or tubular dilated channels scattered in whole of the myometrium and it is somehow approaching to the central part of myometrium also. On color Doppler, this cystic region generate color signal in mosaic pattern representing the same high turbulent heat. And on spectral Doppler, we can appreciate high peak systolic velocity and low resistance. Now in 2023, patient came to us for a follow-up and we did transabdominal as well as transvaginal sonography to characterize the lesion. This is the sagittal and the axial view of grayscale image. Now what we can appreciate is uterus is bulky and there is inhomogeneous ecotexture of myometrium. We can also see the multiple dilated and echoic cystic or tubular channels scattered in the myometrium, predominantly in the posterior myometrium, giving it a spongy appearance. On color Doppler, we can see intense juxtaposed color signals and it also shows color aliasing as red and blue color signals are separated by yellow and white, which is caused by the focal high velocity which are present at the extreme of the color bar. Now on spectral Doppler, we could not differentiate between arterial and venous waveform, but we could appreciate that there is high peak systolic velocity and high diastolic velocity and low RI. The peak systolic velocity was around 59.3 cm per second and RI was 0.17. So summing up our grayscale finding, color Doppler and spectral finding, the uterus appears slightly bulky and there was inhomogeneous ecotexture of myometrium and we could appreciate multiple cystic and echoic lesions in the myometrium. And color Doppler will show color aliasing and spectral waveform shows low resistance. So these kind of findings can be seen in uterine AV malformation, retained product of conception or gestational trophoblastic disease. So to further confirm the diagnosis, contrast engine CT was done and this is the coronal, sagittal and axial view of CT scan in arterial phase and axial view in venous phase. Now what we can appreciate here is multiple dilated tortuous contrast filled vessels in the uterine and parauterine area. The same we can appreciate in sagittal and axial view. And the feeder arteries of this AV malformation were bilateral feeder arteries and the draining veins were bilateral uterine arteries and vein and bilateral ovarian arteries and vein. The same findings we can appreciate on our VR images. We can appreciate multiple dilated and tortuous vascular channel in the uterine wall. And the feeder arteries is uterine arteries and ovarian arteries. Here the uterine bilateral ovarian arteries are dilated and tortuous throughout its course And there is also suggestion that the CV malformation has recruited many feeder arteries from the internal iliac vessels also. So summing up, our grayscale color Doppler and spectral Doppler and contrast CT findings, the final diagnosis was uterine AV malformation, that is arterial venous malformation. Now I would like to invite Dr. Bhavya to continue the talk.
Moving on with our case, based on all the investigations done, coming to the diagnosis, the obstetric causes had already been ruled out. Rest other causes have been ruled out with because of the radiological investigation. So now we are left with our main diagnosis of arteriovenous malformation. Our patient was asked to bring her old records. There was history of uterine artery embolization at our institute in the Department of Interventional Radiology in 2018. And the second attempt was abandoned due to formation of multiple collaterals with bilateral ovarian and bilateral iliac vessels in 2022. So our final diagnosis, 26-year-old, para 3, abortion 4, with no life issues, with bad obstetric history, with uterine arteriovenous malformation, with severe anemia, with history of uterine artery embolization. Now I would like to invite Dr. Priya Sharma, senior resident from the Department of Obstetric and Gynecology.
Good morning, respected faculty and my dear colleagues. I'm Dr. Priya Sharma, senior resident in Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology. Treatment options discussed with the patient were uterine artery re-embolization, medical management and surgical management. Medical treatment options including oral options, oral medications like methylergometrin, combined pills, progesterone, danazol, mifepristone, and injectables including gonadotropin releasing hormone analog, injection levonorgestrel acetate, and injection surgical options. Basically, in uterine arteriovenous malformation, there are estrogen receptors in the endothelial lining of the endometrium. So these drugs, they act by creating a hypoestrogenic effect in the body. And then there is 17 alpha estradiol, which causes Notch 1 receptor signaling and lead to formation of uterine AVF. So these by causing hypoestrogenic effect, they lead to regression of the lesion after, like, if we give GnRH analog for 6 months, there has been seen that these lead to regression of the lesion. So we tried medical management in our patient, and considering her age and fertility, so we tried medical management in our patient. Patient was admitted and anemia was corrected by blood transfusion. She was started on oral progesterone, nor ethistrone acetate, which is a class 1, generation 1 progesterone, and it is a it has slight androgenic activity, and it is given in the dose of 10 mg twice a day for 5 days, followed by twice a day, and her bleeding decreased but did not stop, but she refused for any surgical intervention. So we started her on GnRH analog depot preparation, which was given intramuscularly in the dose of 11.25 mg. Patient attained amenorrhea for 3 months. Hence, we decided to give one more injection of depot GnRH analog preparation. Her hemoglobin improved from 6.5 to 13.8 gram per deciliter during the 6-month course of GnRH analog. And then total follow-up of 6 months, she significantly improved. But due to the hypoestrogenic effects of GnRH analog, if given after 6 months, and due to the high cost of GnRH analog, we switched her to depomidroxyprogesterone acetate, which is given as 150 mg intramuscularly every 3 months, and 4 doses have been given till now, and total follow-up of this patient being 1.5 years, and patient is asymptomatic. Though she was asymptomatic and maintaining her hemoglobin level, but in repeat CT angiography of lower abdomen, there was no regression of uterine arteriovenous malformation. So we have 2 more options for her, either complete feeder embolization of the uterine artery or hysterectomy. So to discuss about uterine artery embolization, I would like to call upon Dr. Rakesh to discuss about it.
I would like to present about the role of intervention in this case. Basically, since we have seen the diagnostic imaging of this patient, a clinical scenario, diagnosis of arteriovenous malformation of the aid. So distal subtraction angiography DSA is a gold standard for diagnosis of uterine vascular anomalies. DSA is a gold standard for diagnosis of uterine vascular anomalies. they can be classified as the instantaneous prototype image. Or the tangle of blood vessels, these are the volume-mediated images, they can be classified as congenital acquired. Most of the cases are acquired AVMs, which has a history of prior DNC, any trauma, prior CSF infections. So, what are the embolic agents we use generally for uterine artery embolization? Embolic agents can be either temporary or permanent. Temporary means that it will be the embolizing agent will last for almost 7, 10, 14 days. And for temporary hemostasis, permanent agents can be particles like polyvinyl alcohol particles, alcohol. Alcohol is no longer used nowadays. Vials and like plugs and balloons. So, how long does it take? It is a minimally invasive modality. The aim is to stop heavy bleeding in these patients. Primary aim is to stop the heavy bleeding in these patients as this patient is very hemodynamically unstable. And second aim is to preserve the fertility and preserve the uterus as much as possible. As these patients, as in this index case, the patient is very young and desirous of fertility. It is generally done under local anesthesia. It takes almost about one and a half hours. And overnight hospital stay is required. Bleeding related symptoms results or significantly improved in almost 98% cases after the procedure. Recurrence is rare, but it does not imply the failure of the procedure itself, because as we all know that uterine AVMs are inherently tend to repeat. So even if we repeat the procedure, it does not imply primary failure of the procedure itself, because our primary aim is to stop the bleeding and secondary aim is to preserve the fertility. So even if we have to repeat the procedure, it does not necessarily imply a failure of the procedure. So what are disadvantages? Because we are embolizing the vessels, it can lead to cracking pain, pelvic pain, but these are generally managed conservatively. And follow-up care is generally 4 weeks after the procedure and MRI is repeated after 6 months. So these are the... So how it is done? This is a prototype image. We generally use a 5 total artery access is used, and we use a 5 wrench. So right pebble artery access, we can see. So this is the common iliac. We go from the left side. Our aim is to generally embolize both the uterine arteries, as uterine arteries generally in vascular malformations they are tend to have a dual supply. So it's always a rule to see both the uterine arteries. So we, depending on the laterality, we in this case went on the left side, left uterine artery is cannulated. This is the second video depicting the anatomical supply, anterior and posterior branch, and we can see this curvilinear. This again the video, we can see the anterior and posterior branches. And this is the uterine artery. Of course, this is the uterine artery. This is very tortuous. Then selective cannulation. Once we identify the uterine artery, selective cannulation of the uterine artery is done. This is the road map of the scene. Again, this is again angiographic images. We can see the uterine artery. And in this. In this image, we can also see this small vessels. This small vessels, which is actually the ovarian artery. So, in uterine AVMs, it is very common to see different anastomosis and different pelvic vasculature. Even ovarian arteries can give the supply. So, it is very important for interventionists to see the arteries before embolizing. Because this, if we embolize it from this point, this can lead to misembolization or ovarian failure, which we do not desire, which is not our aim. So we went more super selective. This is super selective cannulation of the uterine artery. Again, the angiographic images, we went more inside with a microcatheter inside. This is the now we are selectively cannulated the uterine artery. Now this is the image just taken before the embolization. and this is the image. This is the image. We have selectively connected the uterine artery, and the PVA particles in range of 500 to 700 microns was injected. And subsequently, the stem was embolized. The proximal stem was embolized with 30% to 40% view on the left side. Subsequently, right uterine artery run was taken. This is the right sided shoot. We cannulate again with a curved catheter. And this is again, we can see the triangle of blood gush of the cells and adulating veins in the section from the right side. In this, going back, this is the gush of vessel vessels supplied by the right uterine artery. So in this patient, since the aim was generally in uterine artery injection, the aim is to preserve the fertility. So on the right side, only proximal stem was closed with loop. We did not use PVA. The only PVA was not used in this. This is the post embolization on the right side. We can see well see the group gas in situ. So what are the complications? Generally, it is a minimally invasive procedure, so there are fewer side effects. Pelvic pain, blue dead, can occur for 3 to 4 days, which is generally due to analgesic anti-inflammatory. Post embolization syndrome can happen, which manifests as severe nausea or vomiting, which is also managed conservatively. The most dread complication which we always hear of is the ovarian compromise, disembolization, which any intervention urologist would not desire. And sometimes due to over-embolization and post-embolization, it may lead to endometrial infections and influence anaclea formation. This is an article published by our department of uterine artery inflammation, rare cause of normal uterine bleeding. A case is published in Journal of Cardiovascular Research Disease, where uterine artery embolization has been well used. And this 7-8 patients which we described and published in the literature. So now I would like to invite for the course of management. Thank you.
For this kind of management could be uterine artery embolization, complete feeder embolization or hysterectomy. But in both of these options, we would not be able to save for fertility. So to talk about and enlighten us about fertility options for this patient, I would like to call upon Dr. Shishti. Options that this patient has. So first of all, whenever a patient comes to us for any fertility treatment, then first and foremost thing that is important is counseling of that patient. So all the methods of fertility preservation that are available to us has to be discussed with their associated risk and benefit. Alternative treat methods like donor gametes or donor embryo use, in case the patient does not has her fertility preservation prior, then there might be use of donor gametes or donor embryos. And since her uterus is almost 80% acquired by arteriovenous malformation, then she will be in a need of surrogacy. Also, she needs a psychological counseling, and she has previous multiple pregnancy losses, and financial counseling, as this treatment or fertility preservation methods that we use are not that much cheap, or they are not covered by any Medicare. Also, if none of the treatment works for her, then she will be in a need, then she can have a child by adoption. So these are the points that we have to counsel her. Next, coming to initial investigation. So whenever a patient comes to us, so we have to see her ovarian reserve. So these are tested by anti-Müllerian hormone, and this level should be at least more than 1.1 nanogram per ml, and antral follicular count, which should be at least more than 5 to 7 in both ovaries. Hormonal profile is to be done, which is a luteinizing hormone, estradiol level and progesterone level. So these levels should be at baseline. Luteinizing hormone should be less than 5, estradiol level should be less than 50 nanogram, and then progesterone level should be less than 1.1. Now coming to husband semen analysis. Since she has had prior conception, so most likely semen analysis would be normal, but still we would like to have a report in hand. Now these are the fertility preservation options that are available to us. Preferred one is aspiration of mature oocytes with stimulation. This takes a period of 2 to 4 weeks. Then we do IVF, which is in vitro fertilization, or ICSI, which is intracytoplasmic sperm injection, and then do embryo freezing for this patient. The embryos, those are frozen, can be transferred into surrogate mother. So surrogacy which is allowed in India is only altruistic surrogacy, that is only the family member or a close friend can perform a surrogate, and the age should be 25 to 35 and her family, the surrogate mother family should be complete. Other options that are available to us is aspiration of immature oocytes with or without stimulation in case we are unable to complete the stimulation, and then to in vitro maturation and fertilization. Other options available are cryopreservation of ovarian tissue that we will discuss further later. Now IVF exit. IVF with cryopreservation of embryo, this is an option. The patient, since she was on leuprolide 11.25 milligram for 6 months and then on depo-provera, so she is already down-regulated. So hormones must be at the baseline level. So protocol that I would like to use for this patient is antagonist protocol. In this, we start with high-dose gonadotropins, could be urinary or recombinant gonadotropins or FSH, and then we do serial ultrasound monitoring and hormonal profile that include estradiol level, progesterone and LH levels. In case we see that the LH level is increasing, then we will add GnRH antagonist, or we can straight away after giving 5 days of stimulation, we can add GnRH antagonist, which is Cetrorelix, and then after once we have had good numbers of dominant follicles, then we will do oocyte retrieval and forms embryo, and these embryos are then frozen and then transferred to a surrogate mother. Now what is the risk associated with this condition? Since we are doing a stimulation with the follicular stimulating hormones, so this will increase the estrogen levels, and these hyperestrogenic states is known to cause abnormal angiogenesis and vascularity in a case of AVM. So this torrential bleed, if it occurs, then we'll need uterine tamponade, which may or may not work. So this patient may lead into emergency embolization or need of emergency hysterectomy. If IVF fails and patient lands up in emergency hysterectomy, then the option available to us is in vitro maturation, that we will retrieve the immature oocytes and then do their maturation in the lab and then forms the embryo. So cryopreservation of ovarian tissue, we have three options. We do cortical ovarian biopsy. So these fragments are taken and these are frozen as such, and then they are transplanted later on when the patient is asymptomatic. So heterotopic or orthotopic. Orthotopic it is at the site of ovarian fossa and heterotopic in anterior abdominal wall. In case other option that we can do with ovarian cortex is isolate the follicle and then do their in vitro maturation, or we can do avascular transplantation of these isolated follicles. Or third option is freezing whole ovary. So this is a procedure which requires prior informed consent and prior institutional ethical committee approval. Another option that the patient have is of adoption. Now I would like to call Dr. Priyanka to further discuss the literature.
Respected teachers, my seniors and juniors, we have discussed about the case and we have reached to a diagnosis, that is arteriovenous malformation. So I'll be discussing about the basics of arteriovenous malformation. So first let's understand what is arteriovenous malformation. So arteriovenous malformation is generally, there are two types of vessels we know, one is artery and one is vein. Artery has a high pressure blood flow and veins have low pressure blood flow. Generally there is a network of capillaries in between two. So when this capillary network is absent, the high pressure blood flow gets transferred to the low pressure blood flow, and the circulation overall becomes high pressure blood flow. So there is a fistulous connection formed between branches of the uterine artery and myometrial venous plexus, which bypasses normal capillary network, leading to the highly pressurized blood flows from artery into the vein without dissipation into capillary plexus, and it can result in profuse bleeding. So uterine AVMs are of two types, generally congenital and acquired. Congenital AVMs generally formed due to defective differentiation in primitive fetal capillary plexus. It is present in early menarche as hormonal changes induce proliferation and increase the blood flow. The acquired ones are generally which are more common. They can occur due to maybe after spontaneous abortion, due to MTPs, due to DNCs, that is dilatation and curettage, post cesarean section or post vaginal delivery, maybe after carcinoma cervix or endometrium or any malignancy, after uterine infection, any trophoblastic disease, or maybe after endometriosis. What is the pathogenesis of acquired AVM? when there is a transection of the uterine vascular plexus during an invasive procedure like DNC or MTP or any curettage, there is approximation of newly created artery and venous margin. Then the healing process begins when these larger vessels are juxtaposed with no intervening capillary plexus and a fistulous connection may be established upon the resumption of physiologic blood flow. How does the patient present? It can be an incidental diagnosis when she is asymptomatic and investigated for any some other pathology, or she can have vaginal bleeding in the form of either metrorrhagia, that is continuous intermittent intermenstrual bleeding, or menorrhagia, that is heavy flow, heavy bleeding, heavy continuous bleeding following dilatation and curettage, miscarriage, post hysterectomy, trophoblastic disease following LSCS, or normal delivery in the form of postpartum hemorrhage. Or she can also present with postmenopausal bleeding. During examination, generally her general and systemic examination is usually normal. In cases of severe bleeding, she can have pallor, tachycardia due to anemia. Vaginal examination may demonstrate blood through cervical loss, indicating uterine bleeding. So when we do the investigation, generally the hematology is sent, including full blood count, PTINR and APTT, that is coagulation, to rule out any coagulopathy. There will be anemia, so hemoglobin might be low. Biochemistry blood tests are also sent, that is renal function test and liver function test in case we want to start her on some medical management. Beta-HCG or urine pregnancy test is done to rule out any obstetric causes, that is pregnancy. The radiological investigations, as we discussed, usually done are ultrasound with transvaginal ultrasound and with Dopplers. CECT or CEMRI can also be done, and digital subtraction angiography, that is selective angiography, is routinely done, and it is the gold standard test. Upon confirmation, embolization is done under local anesthesia which stops bleeding. Recurrences can develop subsequently. So what are the treatment options? And the treatment options are adopted depending on the age of the patient, size of the AV malformation, location of AV malformation, and desire of patient for future fertility. The options can be either expectant or conservative management if patient is asymptomatic. Medical management, as we have discussed already, with the hormones and the other oral and injectable preparations. Then selective angiography and super selective embolization of feeding arteries of AVM, and hysterectomy for severe massive bleeding. What can be the differential diagnosis? Some of the differential diagnosis can be retained products of conception, gestational trophoblastic disease, and hemangioma. It is usually ruled out on the basis of all the factors like history, examination, and the radiological investigation. So we rule out all the differential diagnosis accordingly. So moving on to the review of literature, actually since still it is very rare, but the diagnosis has increased because of the because of the better diagnostic radiological modalities we have. So the data is very scarce. Whatever we found was most of the literature was of case reports. We could found very limited studies. Like this is a study which was done in 2018, and it was a prospective study of 959 patients. And they found that sonographically evident uterine AVMs after dilatation and curettage was found in 5.2% patients, and after delivery in 0.22% patients. However, only one, that is only 0.1% AVM, was deemed clinically significant. Similarly, this is a very good meta-analysis done. It was done in 2021. It includes 121 premenopausal studies patients, and 32 studies were included in the meta-analysis, and it showed that overall success rate of medical management was 88%. So medical management for uterine AVM is a reasonable approach in well-selected patients, and it was published in the Fertility and Sterility Journal. There is another case report which shows in this patient the gonadotropin releasing hormone agonist therapy was started, and it has been proven that it has the potential to be a conservative treatment modality for uterine AV malformation in hemodynamically stable patient, and the lesion completely disappeared after 6 months of GnRH agonist therapy. Although it could not happen in our patient, although the patient was symptomatically better and she was feeling the general well-being was also attained, but the lesion could not be regressed even after the treatment for 1.5 years. Same, there is another case report in which the patients with class 1-2 hemorrhage were treated with DMPA plus ranexamic acid, and they had a higher rate of uterine AVM resolution versus UAE. So to conclude, The uterine and pelvic AVMs are a rare cause of catastrophic vaginal bleeding from asymptomatic to catastrophic, that is patient can die of uterine bleeding. Uterine AVMs are typically acquired, whereas pelvic AVMs are classically congenital. Digital subtraction angiography is gold standard for the diagnosis. Transcatheter embolization is mainstay of treatment. Definitive treatment is hysterectomy. In present case, the primary outcome of success was that no subsequent procedural interventions were required. Secondary outcome of success was that no readmissions or transfusions were need to be done in a follow-up period of 1.5 years. Still, close clinical follow-up and imaging will be required. So our take-home message is, uterine AVM is a relatively rare condition. It warrants consideration in the differential diagnosis of vaginal bleeding. Routine gynecological evaluations such as hysteroscopy or DNC, it may aggravate hemorrhage. So we should be, at least we should have in mind the DD of AVM before proceeding for any invasive procedure. And management strategies are unique. So in the end, I would like to thank the management on the behalf of our Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology. I would like to thank the management of Mahatma Gandhi University of Medical Sciences and Technology and CCR Reviewing Committee and the collaborative departments. And we also extend our gratitude to the patient and her family for providing us with this learning opportunity. She is our patient and she is a relative of our sister. Now she's doing well, she's happy because she has improved a lot. About she had come to us for hysterectomy because she's just 26 years old, but she was so pissed off with her vaginal bleeding, she could not do her routine work. But now her hemoglobin has been maintained from 13.8 since 1.5 years, so she is very happy with this. Thank you.